Bertolt Brecht once wrote, "There are men who struggle for a day, and they are good. There are others who struggle for a year, and they are better. There are some who struggle for many years, and they are better still. But then there are those who struggle all their lives, and these are the indispensable ones." Aaron Swartz was one of the indispensable ones. As you have heard, Aaron was a very complex and wondrous soul, and I feel so privileged to have been one of the people who got to see him in all these other forms. His loving, he loved Ada, he was so patient, he was just, you know, we say the beautiful soul, it's hard unless you met him to know how sincere and authentic that really was. This was the person that he had become. And he was also, though, this consumer team, consummate team member who could be part of the broader human race in one most wondrous ways. His primary work when working at Thoughtworks was to lead and build the next generation of tools for organizing and democratizing campaign. He was deeply worried that this wonderful world of technology that had been created was going to be usurped and not end up being a tool of democracy with the small d. So when I first met him, he was like, all these ideas, he was saying, "Roy, you know, I've studied these campaigns and how we've done so well. I've got this idea for how to do A/B testing with campaigns, but one of the things we have to guarantee is that a woman in India, in rural India, with her simple cell phone, she could run the campaign that she wants without the need for the experts and for others." He was that much of a caring person. He was, in my humble opinion, one of the true extraordinary revolutionaries that this country has produced. He was a leader. He was a mentor. When we first gave him his team in here in New York, we got people from all over the world to work, you know, for him. But you know, he's a clever guy. He's all people he hasn't met. So what does he do? He puts on the theme song for the Muppets and starts singing the Muppet song and then starts pairing away with all the developers. For those of you who don't know developers, it's not a normal sort of mode of operandi. And within minutes, he had mesmerized and inspired and changed the dynamics of his interactions. You know, we had a moment of silence across the world in all of our 20-something offices. And, you know, it's hard to say how he had been on a video conference with me in front of about 1,000 people. We had live streamed when we were actively trying to figure out how to launch the campaign for his defense. And he couldn't say much about the, you know, the campaign itself, but he desperately wanted to show people, you know, that this was not about Aaron. This was about a broad issue. He was so uncomfortable in that moment because he knew that he had been railroaded into something that was a side issue on the scheme of his master agenda. He was truly, as The Economist, not my favorite magazine, but he said, truly in The Economist, he was a commons man. He deeply wanted to protect humanity's intellectual treasures as part of these commons. Economically, he believed that the creation of academic and intellectual property was a social process, often paid by the governments and by the public. And as had been the case with libraries in previous centuries, he demanded that they stay part of the public good. He also was not, I mean, I have to say, unfortunately in our industry, in this technology industry, we have a lot of egomaniacs and egotists. He was not that. He firmly believed that the accident of his considerable intellectual prowess gave him no right to appropriate the essential good that is the common tradition of the human race, which is intellectual knowledge. We were at the funeral with his father, and I know some of you are parents here. There is nothing more wretched, as you know, to having to give a eulogy for your own son. And Bob did it in the most humane in a way that all of us cried, of course, when he spoke. But then he made something that stuck a knife in my heart. He made a very lucid point about the duplicity of our society that protects those who accumulate wealth and treats those like Aaron in a completely different fashion. You heard just a few moments ago how many young students who are, you know, precocious with technology do things. It is well known that Mark Zuckerberg, Bill Gates, Steve Jobs bent the rules for their own good. They did it for themselves.
Right.
They engaged in shady practices of use of public property whilst at the university in their early days. None of them faced 35 years in prison.
Right.
Instead, they have amassed great wealth. They are worshipped. Yet here's Aaron, somebody whose life is the exact opposite of these people. I've met Aaron. You cannot imagine a polar opposite of beauty in human beings. Mm. And here is the opposite of that. And yet he fought every moment. He lived his truth. He only worked on the important. He really, really did. There was not a day that he didn't do that. And yet he used his incredible talents and privilege for the advocates of those without. So we have a choice. But Bob taught me at that funeral, we have a choice today. We have this very small and unique opportunity in history to shake up the control by these self-aggrandizing egomaniacs who use technology for the good of the 1%. This is not something that Eric's legacy is to kill that. Aaron was a systems thinker, and he saw that this large accumulation of economic wealth in the form of private corporations was subverting everything in its path. He was, as his close friend David Siegel said, a communitarian. It is these ideals that we should uphold. His views on students, he gave this speech, some of you have seen it, I think, on Democracy Now!, some of the clips, but in his speeches, he was encouraging US students to think about their own privilege, because when they have to go to an elite university and they have all these Juris Doctor documents, he made the salient point that opportunity doesn't exist for the young child in India. What right do we have for that knowledge which has come from the ages of the Enlightenment? And he's just so clever in how he constructs the right frame of thing that he said, you know, this is the way we can deal with open access and social justice. He was always challenging us. He's always amazed all of us who looked at him and said, how do you come up with this idea to figure this way in this correct way? He's just that kind of guy. But tonight I also want to tell you about a side of Aaron that is very important to me because I grew up all over the world. Aaron was a deeply internationalist soul. A few weeks ago, I had invited a small group of progressive Muslims into our offices to talk about how we deal with the growing violence against Muslims and people that people think are Muslims in our country. This was just after the subway event where the woman had pushed, you know, the young man into his death. And so, as is my nature, I'd seen Aaron early in the day. I said, Aaron, you gotta come to this meeting, man. I was dropping, going, chopping the meeting. And of course, Aaron did that. And he came to the meeting, you know, in the evening. I was actually on Skype at that point. And as always, here's Aaron listening for an hour to all of these complicated things, both of us learning about, you know, what is the status of, you know, the politics of the Muslim community here in the United States, et cetera. But absorbing all of this thing. And here, most of us are probably double his age. And he wakes and all of a sudden he begins to talk and he says, I think you guys have framed this issue incorrectly. The right way to frame this issue is we have to conduct a campaign against the merchants of hate. And there was silence. He had properly characterized what was the issue at hand in a way that everybody in America could understand and that we could understand. And I want to tell you that the people who are in that room with Aaron are sitting here today weeping at the loss of Aaron. And they've asked me, Roy, how can we allow our country to take away this beautiful voice? Here is this young, beautiful Jewish kid. He's a kid to me. I know he's a man, but that voice had no right to be taken from us. It had no right. And I I rotated between sadness and crying and anger when I know that when people like that are taken and we don't raise our voices, we are complicit. And I'm so proud and so many of history to understand our next tasks. I mean, understand, Aaron touched so many of us in the progressive community that we were unable to sort of figure out what is the strategies and tactics of next. But he was a consummate study. He wanted to be a historian, had a sociologist, then many things. Revolutions are made by people. They're not made by heroes. But nevertheless, leaders matter greatly everywhere in the world. Our country has a tradition of creating a climate of fear whenever they risk change. This climate of fear started, obviously, under slavery, but even in the post-slavery period under Reconstruction, when you had the Jim Crow laws, we introduced fear in the post-Reconstruction South. We've witnessed the McCarthy period. We are now witnessing the war against terror and the rise of Islamophobia in our country. And when our government fails to intimidate, they silence their opponents. Fifty-two years ago, Patrice Lumumba was murdered by the Belgian and United States government in the Congo. He was one of the most important leaders of his generation, and in fact, centuries in Africa. He was that significant. It took us almost 40 years for it to be impossible for the United States to deny that they had a role in his assassination. 45 years ago, in the jungles of Bolivia, Che Guevara was assassinated on the orders of the CIA. Aaron knew and decided consciously the system with which he was taking on. Aaron was a target of the FBI. After the Pacer incident, they followed him. He was strip searched. Let's not pretend that this was not a political issue of Aaron's voice on SOPA and the rest of the issues that he fought. Last December, I was able to introduce two of my, I have a number of heroes, but two of them very close to me. One is Aaron, and the other is P. Sainath, who is India's leading, living British journalist, who's covered rural poverty in India for the last 20 years, you know, which, as you know, is a very difficult story. And the two of them, three of us actually, began talking. So I wrote him, you know, I think in the second day, and he think he'd heard. And this is what Sainath wrote back to me. This was, and I say it without hesitation, not suicide. It was murder by intimidation, bullying, and torment. Today, we are left with a number of issues to fight in the wake of Aaron's passing. First, we must demand accountability for those who tormented Aaron. We do not do so to personalize the issue or to seek revenge. That is not our motivation. We understand that if we allow the climate of fear to exist, the damage that will be done is that the next Aaron will not come. That is a future that we will not accept in our world. That is a future unacceptable. During our annual retreat this summer, Aaron had joined 500 of his colleagues, and we had a number of speakers discussing one of the more egregious cancers of our country, which is the US justice system. We have 5% of the world's population, and yet 25% of the prisoners in the world are incarcerated in our country. African Americans now account for 1 million of the 2.3 million prisoners. 80,000 people, as we sit here today, are in constrained confinement or solitary confinement. Solitary confinement has been condemned by the United Nations as a form of torture. And Aaron, he was deeply conscious of privilege. He really thought, and he would not have wanted it to be in history that it would take somebody of his stature and his connections to bring attention to this play and abusive system of plea bargaining in America. Aaron is like many of tens of thousands of Americans who don't have his influence and doesn't have his friends, the wonderful people we have here. This system that is in America today is an abuse of state power. A fitting legacy for Aaron would be the dismantling of this system. Yeah. And a second and more direct legacy must be to change the Computer, Wire, and Abuse Act. We must help Congresswoman Lofgren craft the right language. It has to not only be about getting rid of the question of criminalizing terms of service, it has to get rid of this ambiguity that's in the law so that unscrupulous prosecutors from Boston to Maine to wherever they are in this country, they don't have the latitude that they had to go after Aaron. We have to make sure that doesn't happen. I want to close with the words of Frederick Douglass, one of the greatest leaders of our country, who spoke in this very hall about over 100 years ago, a few years after the emancipation from slavery. The whole history of the progress of human liberty shows that all concessions yet made to her august claims have been born of earnest struggle. If there is no struggle, there is no progress. This struggle may be a moral one, or it may be a physical one, or it may be both. But it must be a struggle. Power concedes nothing without a demand. It never did, and it never will. Find out just what a people will submit to, and you have found out the exact amount of injustice and wrong which will be imposed upon them. And they will continue until they are resisted, either with words or blows, or with both. The limits of tyrants are prescribed by the endurance of those whom they oppress. Dearest Aaron, we loved you dearly. Aaron was like a son to me, and it's very hard to describe the last week. Aaron, you were a gentle giant. You believed in the constant struggle to right the wrongs of the world that previous generations had failed to correct. And for that, I looked at Aaron and said, I know that I have not done my duty in my generation. I feel that deeply. You refuse to accept injustice as inevitable. You have touched and inspired us all with your vision of the social injustice for every person, every living person on this planet. We promise today with our deepest hearts to carry on your legacy to the best of our abilities. Brother Aaron, one love.